party with you. Come on. And have a
239. I'm coming for your neck.
We gonna celebrate and have a good time. It's time to come together.
Lee County, I'm coming for you.
Everyone around the world. Come on.
It's a celebration.
Celebrate good times, come on.
Let's ride.
It's a celebration. Celebrate good times, come on. Let's celebrate.
It's your boy, Triple B-L-A-C-K, a.k.a. the number one stunner, a.k.a. the boss, a.k.a. Harlem Lake, Town, and Pine Manor, all black bitch. You already know what it is, man. Anyways, man, I'm in the heart of the city, and you are listening to No Cup Cake Zone. No Cupcake Zone. Before you do anything, man, go to Spreaker right now and follow me. That way you'll get all my podcasts first. Also, go to iTunes, and that way you'll get all my podcasts and my future podcasts too. Stitcher Radio, I'm at your neck too. You already know what it is. I'm changing the game. No Cupcake Zone. Anyways, man, I got my website, nocupcakezone.com. Hey, go there and add it to your favorites, because I'm bringing content there. You know what I'm saying? A 239 Unscripted. It's my other show that I'm doing, but this is No Cupcake Zone right now. Anyways, man, hey, I've been through Collier County, and I'm going to Lee County right now. Anyways, man, fuck with your boy. Hey, I'm in Lee County right now. And, man, this is a very special interview, man, because I played against this cat and his team. Actually, one of the most overlooked teams. They were a great runner-up, and they won the district. Man, 5A district back in the day, like in 1998, 99, even before then, man, was a beast. You know what I'm saying? You had Estero, Fort Myers, Naples, Lely, Barron, you know what I'm saying? Lehigh put out teams, Cape Coral, you know what I'm saying? It was a strong, strong district, you know what I'm saying? Port Charlotte. Hey, man. Anyways, man, I got the Mack truck. Travis Taylor, man. But, hey, we're going to chop it up, man. Estero Wildcats stand up. Fort Myers stand up. 239 stand up. This is No Cupcake Zone. Hey, man, I'm about to take a little short break, man. Hey, man, we back in the building, No Cupcake Zone. Taylor on the line right now. I nicknamed him the Mack Truck, his nickname was. I'm sure it was something, man. But round of applause, man.
Man, they call me the Diesel. They call me the Diesel.
The Diesel.
The Diesel.
Okay. I'm talking about, man. Is it because you drove trucks, or were you doing a little something else?
relayed our bodies.
Hey, man, fuck with me, Lee County, man. Out on No Cupcake Zone, man. You know what I'm saying? I tried to get out here, man. But hopefully this is a start of something, you know what I'm saying, nice, man, because y'all, you know what I'm saying? I can't say 239 without including everybody, you know what I'm saying? But anyways, man, what's good, Travis, man?
Man, listen, man, I'm sitting here soaking up life, enjoying what we call it, man.
Yeah, man. So where you at, man? I mean, you ain't got to give me your exact location, man.
I'm in Lehigh, but I'm still 239.
Okay, all right. That's 239, man. You already know.
Yeah.
Anyway, you know it, man. Dog, you know what? It wasn't until a while ago. Actually, I was having a conversation with a friend. I was like, because I remember Estero teams. And I was like, when I was in the game, I was like, man, you go to Estero, you ain't nothing but like country folks and big old, you know, rednecks and stuff like that. And then I was like, in the game, there was about all the, you know, cats that they had at skill position. Your quarterback had gold teeth. You know what I'm saying? You had people with dreads and stuff. I was like, man, they ain't nobody like that in Estero. Where the hell they getting these?
Listen, man, they bust us from the hood, man. We was in the hood of 4 miles, man, Michigan, man, 4224. You already know.
Really?
Yeah, man. They bust us in every day.
Dog, that was crazy because I was like, you know, they had like, you know, before y'all, they had like Anthony Dixon, Anthony Henry, and all that. And I was like, you go to Estero, there's no black people, man. So that, it made sense to me, man. Yeah, so they bust you guys, man. Dang, you just actually gave me, you know, gave me some knowledge because I always see this 4224. I never knew what it was, man. So it's Michigan.
Yeah,
it's
Michigan Lynx. Michigan Lynx, man.
All right, man. Dog, so you were born and raised in Fort Myers?
Born and raised. Livermore Hospital, man.
Yeah, man. That's what's up, man. I'm in the heart of the city right now, man. I ain't going to give my location, but, you know, just say I'm in the heart of the city. Martin Luther
King. Much love. That's what I'm talking about. Hey, I still love it. That's my place.
Yeah, man. So, yeah, Michigan, man, that's a wild, wild place, man. Actually, one of my best friends growing up, man, Cedric Morgan, man. Shaw Fuse grew up there, man. Around that area.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Man, a lot of people came through Michigan, man. Yeah. Listen, man, Fort Myers itself, man, is a blessing. Yeah. I mean, I know there's a lot of stuff going on right now, but, man, that's the city, bro. That's where you grow through. You find a lot of stuff. You see a lot of stuff. And it helped you grow as a person and as a man.
Yeah, bro. Yeah, definitely, man. What I like about here, man, is like the culture a little bit, man. You know, the food. I'm a big dude, so, you know what I'm saying? I appreciate going to, you know, City Fish, you know, so get me a fish sandwich, you know.
Yeah,
hey,
man.
You
got to hit the little Jamaican
yet.
Spot.
Yeah, the Jamaican
spot.
You got
to hit that Jamaican. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, man. Yeah, I haven't been to Speedy's yet, man. You know, because I'm still kind of feel my way around here, man. And I don't want to be the new.
You gotta go. Yeah. You gotta go, man. You can't go to 4 miles without hitting Speedy, man.
Yeah, man. I heard it. I heard a podcast that Plies did, and he gave a shout out to them, man. Wow. I mean, it must be pretty good, man. You got celebrities shouting them out.
You can't. I'm telling you, you can't hit a 4 mile without stopping by Speedy.
Man, where are some other spots, man? Because I know there's a spot where some soul food, it's in the hood. It's like off a beaten path, man. I can't remember the name, but people keep talking about it, man.
The best place I say go to, man, is when you go to the farmer's market right there, man.
Yeah.
That's where the food at, man. Hit the farmer's market up. If you're going to do anything.
No, I hit that this morning. Yeah, I know about the farmer's market.
Man, that's the truth, man. That's all you really need. When you hit the, I mean, you got those little side streets, but hey, man, like, what's that farmer's market, man?
Yeah. Damn, so Michigan Project, man. You a big cat, man. Did you grow up playing Pop Warner football?
I played no Pop Warner football.
Nah.
I went out, but I never played in a game, man. I just played. I probably went out for like first like 3 weeks, man. And that was it, man. Me and my little cousin, Rod, man, we was at practice one day. And his old girl come pick us up. We walked all the way from Buckingham Park back to Michigan Link. And once we got back home, we said enough for that. We already skilled enough. We polished enough. We just waited to get in high school because we was always working anyway. So yeah. Once we got to high school, that's when things kind of took off.
Yeah.
No part Warner. Yeah. We played baseball.
Baseball. So is that why everybody in Fort Myers fast, man? Because if you live in a hood, man, because I know back in those days, shots were ringing. So you had to be your head on a swivel and get out and dodge a lot. Did you attribute a lot of your speed to that?
No, man, I attribute my speed to just them gorillas, man. We used to go out there in the diamond, man. A lot of people don't know. We go out there in the diamond probably 10, 11 o'clock at night. We hit the light poles on. Turn the light poles on. We'll play football. Everybody get tired and want to go home. So, I mean, we go out there. We throw the football up. Next thing you know, you got a crowd. You got a ball game at nighttime.
Yeah. So did you guys ever play Sandlot football against other hoods?
Man, listen, we dominated other hoods. We'll get on our bicycle by 12, 13 guys deep. We'll go into, like, say, for instance, the Palmetto. We'll hit Palmetto. We'll hit Save a Palm up. We'll go throw the football out. I guess they felt some type of way, and they came out there. But they ain't no boy. We're real.
Yeah.
Yeah, we were, man.
Play in the field out there, the old projects off of, I think, Edison?
Oh, yeah, we played in the field out there, too, man. I had some good times out there, man. Yeah, that was a blessing playing out there. Yeah. Them cats, they were some big old cats out there, boy.
Yeah. Who were some of the cats you grew up with, man?
Man, my homeboy, Andrew Layton, my homeboy, Cheo Garcia, David Hall, Rod Watson. You know what I mean? We got Chris Singleton. Look, that's a young cat, young generation right there. You know, Adrian Hall, Plug, Joe Buck, Joe Buchanan. I mean, you name them, man. I've seen them.
Yeah, yeah. Damn. Yeah. So they was all out in the field playing, man. So.
Listen, I'm telling you, when I tell you we was animals, man. That's all we did. See, we bred that. That's all we did. It was football, basketball. You pick it. No matter where we go, battle home, you name it, we was there with a football plan.
Yeah, man. Doggy, so what? You know what I can't understand, man? You know, Fort Myers used to be strong and united. And the reason I say that, because I remember we used to play, you know, I'm from Naples. You know, we used to come down. Yeah. I remember we played AAU basketball one time at the Stars Complex. You know, and it was, everybody was all about Fort Myers was just one. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I was actually a team manager, man. One dude robbed me for a Gatorade, dog, outside.
It's real. But it's real, man.
It's like some of these cats that be beefing and doing all this stuff, don't they remember, you know, when they were playing Sandlot football with each other and stuff like that, man?
But, see, That way the problem came at. The Sandlot football game stopped. Yeah. They don't take it as a passion because it's so much ways to get money. They ain't enjoying life no more. They trying to create another life.
Right. Right. Yeah, man. Because it seemed like everybody know each other, man. So, you know,
And it's crazy. I'm going to tell you what's crazy about it. Half of them don't even know their family. That's what's sad. Everybody in the city of Fort Myers is some kin to somebody some kind of way.
Right.
That's what's crazy. You find out a lot of stuff, man, just by meeting people. Like, I got people that live in Fort Myers right now. That's my cousin. And don't really know we cousins. You know what I mean?
That's some crazy shit, man. You might just be somewhere and it go down, and that might be blood. Blood, yep. Real blood. That's crazy, bro. That's crazy. So you played baseball growing up?
Yeah, man. I played for the Indians at the Stars Complex, man, as a little kid, man. That was our way out. We always tried to figure out something to do because before I moved to Michigan, I stayed in the project. the old project that they tore out. You know what I mean? Then I moved from there. I moved to a place called Handy Court, which is LCP. That's what we call it, Left Corner Posse. That's what it was. So the biggest thing for us, it was a walk. So we could walk from Handy Court to the Stars Complex. And the Stars Complex was our way to do things because they had the basketball courts, they had the baseball fields, they had the swimming pools. So it was something to do to hang out. You know what I mean? And when I say hang out because everybody you can hang out, play with, talk with, Joe, with Ernest Graham came through there, Philip Buchanan came through there. You name the athletes, they came through the Stars Complex.
Yeah.
Playing baseball. Brandon Battle, you know, guys like that, they played baseball coming up.
Yeah. Damn.
Yeah, I wasn't good as them though. I wasn't good. I was just I could run a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah. So you remember all the lily dilly spots and the candy spots and everything, huh?
Funny story. First funny story was when I had my taste of lily dilly. I was standing on Handy Court. Probably about 10, 11 years old. It was this lady named, we used to go get the lily dilly. And we found out later in life that the lily dilly that she had was made out of sulfur water.
What?
Straight sulfur water, man, like sewer water, whatever you call it. It was sulfur water. It's that stained water. She used to freeze it, you know, because if you freeze it, the taste kind of go away until you hit that juice on the bottom. Once you hit that juice on the bottom, then you know it's a funny taste after that. I mean, bless her heart, though. She was trying to keep the kids happy on the street. And then when we got to Michigan, we went to Michigan. We had this lady named Ms. Mona. The best spot in Michigan, man. Everybody went to her house. You didn't stay in Michigan without going to her house.
Yeah.
She had everything from the pink cookies on down.
Damn, boy. I miss those days, bro.
Who you telling?
Man, it was, average day was just, you know, getting on bikes, either going fishing, playing basketball, playing football. That's all we cared about, man. No, you know, who got this or whoever, you know what I'm saying? That was just it.
Man, listen, we used to put each other on the handlebar. Some people stood on the back of the pigs. If we ain't had a bicycle, somebody had a bicycle, we gonna get us a bicycle and we gonna roll, man. And we just gonna have fun. We might not come back home till dark time. You ain't gotta worry about nobody getting shot. We was out having fun, man.
Yeah, bro. Yeah. Man, so how did you get into football, bro?
I started playing sandlot, like I say, when I was standing in the old closet, when we stayed on Handy Court. The big guys, you know, the guys at the time, they was in like high school, you know, late middle school, early high school years, like the Isaac, you know what I mean? Those Bobby Hart, Mike Kelly, them type of guys, they would go to the field at Franklin Park. And they would play football. And I had my cousin, it was named Aunt, we call her Perk. I would just come out there and I'd stand around. And one day I was standing around, and just standing around. He was like, come on, we was a man short. Come on, come play. And next thing he knew, he pitched me the ball. Once he pitched me the ball, it was like a natural instinct to just run. So I was like, oh my God, this is, you know.
Yeah.
From that day forward, I got with my cousin. My mama had took me to my cousin in Battle Home, named Keelan Johnson, man. He used to take me in the backyard because he was, him and my cousin Corey Davis, they was like, you know, they were big football. And he put some cans down, shoes down, whatever, and he started teaching me about the holes. So once he started teaching me about the holes and stuff like that, we would go out probably 3-4 days a week and we just throw the ball, play around. Like I said, I never played part one. He showed me everything that I needed to know. Bless him.
Yeah. Man, God, I remember there used to be some hurt feelings out there at the court. I mean, we used to, actually in Naples, we really didn't play that much on the field. We used to play on the basketball court. You know, one person would be an all-time quarterback, man. But I would just say, there used to be some hurt feelings, though.
man, we played in the road, man. I'm talking about the road and gravel. Yeah, man, it ain't no, if you the quarterback, that don't mean nothing. Once that ball leave your hands or you decide to pull that ball down, if you don't score, you in trouble because you're going to feel what that pavement felt like. And boy, it wasn't nice.
It was nice, man.
So, man, I remember.
Go ahead.
I remember one time, man, before school, man, yeah, this guy we called Duke, William Fletcher, man. We'd be out there playing, man. This guy, man, a big guy, but he wasn't a typical big guy at the time. This dude was probably one of the baddest dudes, like I called him Baby Sap. He was probably one of the baddest dudes I ever came across, man. This dude was running. And I guess he thought he could outrun Duke around the corner. Duke called him and put him on top of the cop. Boom! I'm talking about just before school. I mean, I was like, holy crap. That's when I knew this guy was for real. He played with us at Estero before he went to Mariner.
Yeah. Yeah. So growing up, man, who did you look up to, man, you know, coming up?
Well, see, that's the thing. I didn't have nobody really besides my cousin Keelan and my cousin Court as far as the football term, because I was a square to the football world. I didn't really understand watching football until I was watching the Florida Gators when they had Fred Taylor, Rita Anthony, Jacquez Green, Danny Wolfer, them guys right there. That's when I started watching football.
Yeah.
But I was a square to football. All I knew was Sandlot. I didn't know football, you know, as far as organized, because we never had that. I never had the opportunity.
Yeah. I would imagine that you would have, you know, liked the bus. You know what I'm saying? That's
remember. Once I,
Jerome Bettis.
Once I started, as far as probably when I got in high school, I'm going to tell you who I really liked before I really found the bus. Natron Mean.
That's what I was about to say, because you were number 20. Yeah. I was about to say that. For the Chargers.
No, that was my man.
Yeah.
That was my man, Natron Mean. He was the man. And then, like I said, I started watching Jerome Bettis, the bus. And then I really wore number 20 because Barry. Because I felt like I could move like Barry, and he was strong. He was, a lot of people thought he wasn't fast. He was quick.
Yeah.
You know, but he was powerful, and a lot of people didn't really get a chance to see that. If you see some of the cuts, his cuts was powerful. They wasn't just quick cuts, they were power cuts.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that's why he really intrigued me, you know, and when I started understanding the game.
Yeah, man. So talk about your freshman year going into Estero, man.
Oh, man. Listen, man. Freshman year. We was all, we like to say, we was coming from Michigan. It was all, it was me, myself, Brian Murph, Karen Scott, which is my own boy, Teddy, my little cousin, Rod Watson. We had a guy named Mimi. And we had we had so many guys from the hood come out and play as freshmen with us. So it was kind of an easy transition playing the game, because to me, all football was Sandlot, but they just put these guys in front of you.
Yeah.
And then that's when I met the guys like Eric McKee, Mike Bishop, it's a Charlie. Yeah, man, it was so many guys that I met. That was the guy from Estero. You know, I met those guys, and as we started playing the game, they started saying, you know, put you in position, and I ended up playing wing at first. The guy carried it, he played the four. So, you know, it was easy, because all we was doing was pretty much give us the ball and we run. If we knew how to run, Teddy and them guys, they had the privilege of playing part one. I never played. So they were just like, all right, we're going to run a 28 sweep. All right, I know how to run, give it the ball, and let's go. And then you put a guy in front of that blocking up in the hood. All the blocks we had were crackback blocks.
That's like, you get it, I'm going to find you and I'm going to whoop your ass, nigga block.
Yeah, you know. So now you put these guys in front of me, these guys big, and not only big, they can run. Oh, man, I love this game. What I've been doing my whole life, you know what I mean? One of them tight moments.
Yeah.
So first game took off. I think I had like five touchdowns.
Yeah. So you played varsity or freshman ball?
My freshman year I played freshman ball. That was a rule. That was one of the biggest rules at Estero. You had to play freshman ball. I don't care how good you was, you gonna play freshman, because they had guys like on varsity who I looked up to when I first got there. Their name was Charles Maddox. To me, I still think he was the best running back in Lee County. Because, man, you could get this guy the ball, pay him two or three times a game, he's going to score two or three times a game. This is the best guy I ever seen touch the ball. That's just me.
Maddox?
Yeah, Charles Maddox, man.
Okay.
He was probably the best running back I seen. Me. I'm talking myself person. This guy was for real, man.
Yeah. From Michigan?
Yeah, from Michigan.
Yeah.
And then you had the guys like, I watched film, like Derek Henderson. You know what I mean? Guys like that. They went, you know what I mean? They was product of Estero too. So that dude was real. You know what I mean? But I only seen film of him. And I knew that's who, if I can get to his level, we got a chance to be something special.
Yeah. And let me ask you, I know you guys were zoned for Estero, but were you guys upset that you guys had to go Estero and not Fort Myers or Cypress Lake or one of those places?
Yeah, Not upset, because you got to remember, we kids, we a bunch of kids from the hood, from Michigan.
Right.
We didn't care where we went. We just knew it was another possibility. You know what I mean? It was something strong, because you got to remember, man, Fort Myers had all this talent already, right? Riverdale had talent already. Cypress, they had talent. North had talent. But Estero, this is down the street. Not saying they have talent, but they have, you know what I mean? You ain't going to be able to go to school with all your brothers and play football with your brothers? Oh, my God. I mean, it was nothing to be upset about. It was a different coach now, but it was nothing to be upset about.
Yeah. Yeah, because you guys had to grow up with all the guys, and then all of a sudden, man, it's just you're going to another place that, you know, it was all, I mean, all you guys probably pretty much stuck together because it was just none of y'all, huh?
No, not really. I mean, listen, only of us was the one that came out that school bus.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That school bus that came through the hood picked us up.
Yeah.
You understand? But the key was, it wasn't about us once we figured it out. Once we figured it out, it was about us coming together. Like, man, I tell you what, if it wasn't for the ones down there, the kids that was already there, their parents, like the Nick Hills, the Arnolds, you know, the Rollins, the Bishops, those people invited us into their house. We stayed the night at their house. They fed us. They treated us like we was their kids.
Yeah, man.
So, yeah, I mean, that was a blessing itself. So going down there was a blessing for us, because it showed us something different than what we seen at home.
Yeah. But they, you know what I used to couldn't understand about Estero? Because growing up in Pop Warner, like, for the Naples Gators and like, the Estero Mustangs used to be, like, the game that, you know, it was like from Mighty Mites all the way to Senior Gators. Like, that was a checkoff game. Like, we're going to blow these people out. And then
first-half game.
Huh?
That was a first-half game.
Yeah.
You might make it to the end of the second quarter. It's over. Then you might there's a running clock out there.
Yeah, but when we got to high school, because when I was a freshman in high school, Estero was solid. I think they had Anthony Henry. But they always had solid teams. I was like, how could they be so terrible, you know, in Pop Warner? And in high school, they're always, I mean, your coach is a legend, but.
Yeah. Man. Oh my God. The greatest coach ever.
Yeah. He's a legend, but it used to be like, wow. But you guys have some big boys, some big country boys though.
Oh my God, man. You talking about, like, we had guys like Mark and Kevin Shelley. You know, these like the guys we had. Oh my God, you had so many. I'm trying to think of their name, because I don't really want to forget them, man. I'm talking about Dennis Best, called Devo. He, these guys, man, not only were they big, but they was insane. They were crazy, man. Mick Eckhart, you know what I mean? You had guys like that was the cornerstone. We had, oh my God, man. We had, man, I can't think of his name right offhand, man.
There was a guy named Bergman, man. I wrestled.
Wow, Chris Bergman.
Yeah, he was a heavyweight wrestler, man. I remember this guy tore some dude up.
Man, listen, this dude, if we talking about the same dude, Burton, man,
he was a freak. He played tight end. And then
this dude here was a freak, man. I'm going to tell you something, man. This dude used to outrun all skills guys.
Wow.
And he was that big. Yeah, man, this dude was a freak. We had like two or three of them, like Mike Bishop. Absolute freak, man. I think his 40 time was faster than mine. Man, he was bigger than me, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Man, big old calves, man. I mean, them guys, I know a lot of people, I mean, they took their beatings, you know what I mean? But because they played for the Pop Warner teams down there. But when them guys got to high school, them guys was putting in work.
Yeah. Yeah. Charlie Gray, I remember that guy, but he used to
my boy.
Play... In Naples, he played offensive line, but he was a big dude. He was a big
him and his brother. His brother, he had a brother too, man. Yeah, man, Charlie Gray was the man. He was an animal. He played hard for us.
Yeah. I think he was part of the national championship team that the Gators won back in 96. Estero, though. Yeah, man. So your sophomore year, man, did you move up to varsity or did you play JV?
All right, funny story, man. Originally, man, I had an attitude problem, and not so much attitude problem. I was, you know, like I said, I was still trying to find myself. You know, I wouldn't take nothing from nobody. You know what I mean? I'm not going to say I didn't accept responsibility or nothing like that. I was just, if I felt that you talked to me a certain way, I'm going to let you know. You know, I just didn't take nothing from nobody. Me and the head coach, we kind of got into a little scuffle there. So he was talking about putting me on JV. But a guy named Coach Swatch, man, I think he went and he stepped to him and he talked to him and he told him. He was like, you know, this guy got a lot of talent just to be playing JV. You know what I mean? It's just pretty much a waste. And he was like, before we put him on JV, you know, I'll use him on varsity, right?
Yeah.
So, a true story, man, true story. This guy really helped save me. You know, the first five games of my sophomore year, I didn't touch the field. Matter of fact, I hold the cord. The equipment court, I think, I want to believe. I hold the court because the head coach was the running back coach. So, you know what I mean? This guy bumped head. So I followed this guy around the field for the first five games. Didn't even touch the field. I didn't even play special teams. So
who
I was kind
of
like.
What back was it
for you? A guy named Terrence Scott, man. Teddy, man. Yeah. Listen, man, this dude here was nice. This dude was nice. I call him Baby Bo Jackson, man. This dude has so much talent, man. It was insane. You watch this guy work, man. This guy made everything look just easy. You know, so
yeah.
I get to do much props, man. But there was one player in particular, man, him and quarterback Igor Ortiz. We was playing lately for the district championship. And I think it was like fourth quarter. We was coming out the end zone. I think all we had to do was just get the ball from the one because we had just did a goal line stop. And all we had to do was just keep the ball for like, I think a minute or something left on the clock or something like that.
Yeah.
And like the first play, they came out and they fumbled the handoff. So we lost the district that year. I think we lost the district or lost second place to Lately. So this game, we played Mariner, and he was like, all right, Trap, this your shot right here. We're going to give you a shot, fighter. So after five games, here I go, we're playing Mariner, Ernest Graham, the running back for Mariner at the time. My first carry of the game, we go 99 yards. got caught at the one by Terrence Simmons. You know what I mean? So from there on, everything started, you know, it was up. It was seamless from there.
Yeah.
So for my 10th grade year after the fifth game, that's when I first started, you know what I mean, running the ball after that.
Boy, man.
But needless to say, Ernest Graham broke the record on us that game. So, I mean.
I didn't get to see, man, that's one of the travesties, man, I didn't get to see, like, in person, man. But, you know, there's always these players that I wish I would have seen in person. One of them would have been Ernest Graham. The other one would have been, like, Noel Devine. I heard Ernest Graham was just an absolute monster. He just looked like on a different
man. You look at this guy, man. This guy has no neck, man. This guy, oh my god, then he had this little, this line in front of him, man. They get this dude the ball like 40 times a game, and he's punishing you straight 40 times in a row. So, you know, by the time that 20-25 carried Mark get up there, nobody want to tackle him no more. You watch film, man. We used to watch film. When we got ready to play, you actually seen guys moving out of the way as he came through the hole, man. So, I mean, that's the dreams I was chasing right there. I want to be like this guy. I want guys to start moving when I come through the hole. You know what I mean? So yeah. He really showed me that game, man, what it was like to be a big-time running back in Lee County.
Man, you know what's crazy? I still have the scouting reports because I – my senior year, man, when we played you guys out. Man, that offense, man, you guys had was so annoying. That one in the Green Wave offense, man.
Like, it's the same offense. I'll give you a short story on that. Coach Hampton.
Yeah.
He played for Coach Sam. He was an assistant under Coach Sam.
Awesome.
When they opened up Estero, he came to Estero, and he brought that same system to Estero. It was the same system that Fort Myers ran, the same system. I'm talking about exact plays, everything.
Man.
So that.
You secure. So from that point on, you started, man. Do you talk about some notable games, man? Some notable players that you played that year, man, because like, hey, these youngins don't understand 5A district like the gauntlet because you had Naples, Laley, Barron, Estero, Fort Myers, Cape, even was always good, a little bit good.
Man, I'm gonna tell you a story about Naples. I'm gonna tell you a story about Naples, man. We listen. We went down there and beat on Naples so bad, man. Naples took us off the schedule. You hear me? We went down there and beat on Naples. But we played against guys like Philip Buchanan,
yeah.
Terrence Chapman, you know what I mean, Bear White. We had from North, you had, man, North was insane, man. They had like Kenny Benjamin. I mean, oh my God, if you look at North team, North like they had a Super Bowl. Riverdale had Jim Jones, Mike Thomas. I mean, the Eminem twins, man.
Yeah,
oh,
Aaron,
my God.
They had Renard Joseph, Lionel.
Yeah,
Dorf.
Joseph.
Yeah.
We, them guys down there, man, it was every week it was a challenge, man.
Yeah.
I mean, if you took a week off, you got blowed out.
Yep.
I remember coming in that year we went to state, man, we played we had played Cape in the spring game. We played Cape in a spring game. And it was only for a half. Cape beat us 21-0 in a half. But we came back, beat a 49-0 in the season. So, I mean.
Yeah. I had a guest, Rodney Francois, man. He told, he said they played you guys 2 years
ago
in the district tiebreaker.
He was at Laley, right?
Yeah. They beat you.
I think they
beat y'all 1 year, man.
They beat us my sophomore year? One of them years they beat us. They did beat us. They beat Fort Myers.
Well, they beat you guys in Fort, it was them in Fort Myers that actually made it to the playoffs, I think. But
not that year.
Not that year. You said not that year?
Yeah, that year they beat us. That's the year we missed the playoff. We went 8-2.
Yeah.
We went 8-2 and missed the playoff. That was my sophomore year. That's that year we fumbled coming out of the end zone.
Yeah, yeah. Man, Doug, do you remember, you know, some tough linebackers, man? Because I know Lehigh had a monster at a linebacker.
Man, I don't know. I'm going to tell you something, man. Listen, these guys, if any guy that played linebacker in Lee County was an animal.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie to you. From like I say, because you had guys like, imagine, a guy like Terrence Chapman, man. This dude, he was coming out the end, or he was playing linebacker. I don't know where he played, but he was all over the field. Big Fred, right? Many guys all over the field. Not only was over the field, these guys running like in the fours, man. Like 4-4, 4-5, 4-6s, you know what I mean? So it was tough. I mean, it was tough in the 5-8.
Yeah.
And then, because, like, not only did we play 5-8 schools, I think we had a couple, 6-8 schools too, I want to say. We played against or something like that.
Yeah, I think Mariner was 6-A at that time.
Yeah, because we had six and seven, or something like that. I know we were playing against some big old boys. You know, just right here in Lee County. Lee County, people don't realize, man, Lee County, to me, has the most spreaded talent.
Oh, yeah.
The most spreaded talent that you can find anywhere. Because
that's why
you find...
I said, that's why you got South Fort Myers now. That's got a monopoly on it.
That's what I'm saying. These guys, like, you got... people don't realize, if you can get these kids to stay dedicated to one program and build something, these kids, man, I'm telling you, Lee County win back-to-back championship.
Right.
But the problem is, the talent's so spread out that, you know what I mean, it ain't enough to go compete when you start going to play the schools up the road, like St. Thomas's, and you know what I mean, the Lakelands and the Kissimmee Osceolas, and you ain't gonna be able to compete with them because these guys molded already.
Right. Yeah, I always thought Bishop Verreaux was going to be one of those powerhouses because I think they're a private school and they can offer scholarships. I thought they would scoop up all the, you know, all the talent and make a one super team, but that hasn't happened.
But to me, it's design. It's the reason why it didn't happen. Because, see, first of all, you gotta maintain a certain grade point average.
Oh, okay.
You understand? Some of these kids, they got the habit. They thinking they just need the grades during football season. They forget it's the life after football season that help you play the next season. And they start missing school for whatever reason, which I never understood, because what else do you have to do during the day that forces you to miss school?
That's why I always thought when I was like missing school, I went to a period of time I was in a haze too, and I sat there one day and thought about it. I was like, all my friends at school, all the girls at school, everything to do that's fun is related to school. Why the hell am I not at school? Like playing video games every day was just getting boring and stupid.
And that's one of the things I tell kids now is, listen, you can miss school right now if you want to, but what's going to happen when you get out of school, when you got to go to work every day? You going to go lay in that bed and sleep all day and not go to work?
Mm-mm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
To me, the only option you got right now, you turn 17, 18 to the year you graduate, is to go to school.
Yeah.
Because guess what? The only way we going to make it now is with some kind of education. Because, and I don't want to say this, you know, in a negative way towards nobody, but the street game only lasts so long before they find a way to put you in that box.
Oh, man.
Once they put you in that box, you under their control.
Oh.
So why not control your own life by creating the life for yourself through education?
Yeah, you're so right about that, man. After you become grown, I mean, some people take a little bit longer than everything, but when you reflect, man, the streets is so lame. You know, everything about the street, you know what I'm saying? Everything that's bad, you know what I'm saying? All the just all the rats, all the just all the bad things in the streets.
Yeah. And another thing I learned, because now I was currently coaching at Dunbar High School. You know, I've been out there for maybe like the last 6 years, you know, but this guy, Coach Vogt, he always says something that always intrigued me. He always say, nothing good happens after 12 o'clock.
No. There's you know, thing and it all jails and hospitals.
Right. And that was one of his favorite things I always paid attention to, because it makes so much sense, man.
Yeah.
It makes sense.
No, it's really that simple, man. Dang. So, man, dog, so you went 8-2 and didn't make the playoffs. How bad of a taste was that?
Look at it. Next year we went 13-2. That told you everything.
Right. But so you guys were in the gym probably just going ham. Like, man, we can't let this happen again.
And I'm gonna tell you how dedicated that people don't realize. This guy named Dip, man. I don't know his real name like that, but he was Dip. He drive buses for Lee County School System, right? This guy. And I'm going to tell you, this is straight up. This guy came and bust us from Michigan in the summertime. And took us to workouts.
Yeah.
That's how serious we was about football. And this every day that we had a workout, this guy would come get us and took us down there. That's how hungry we was.
Yeah.
And shout out to the coaching staff for making it possible.
Yeah, man, you guys had a small group, too. That was insane about it. I looked at your picture, like your team picture. It looked like you guys barely had, like, 25 players.
Yeah, it was like 22 to 25, I think it was. And then we had some of them that was hurt that didn't even play.
Yeah. So you guys, man, I think, real close.
Yeah, when I tell you family, man, That was what I call a family. Like I said, we never argued as a team. You know what I mean? We always talked about everything, and you couldn't do nothing to nobody on our team without everybody being there. We all Coach Hampton took us to North Carolina camps, man, with FCA. I mean, we did a lot of stuff together. We went to the movies together. We went to a place, they had a little spot in Fort Myers called Zenas, which was a nightclub for teens at the time.
Yeah.
We even went down there as a team. You know what I mean? We did everything together. It was like no separation. And that was the blessing part about going to Estero. It created a family atmosphere for a lot of us. Like, for me, I was one of the few guys that was blessed to have mother and father around. You know what I mean? My mother and father still around to this day. But other kids, they had one or the other. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it was a blessing for us to have that family environment, you know, and that's stuff you can't create.
Yeah.
That a family is something that's it's tough to come by. But when you have it, man, you know it. And that's what I believe was the motivation factor. Because when we worked out, it was like, we didn't say, oh, you sorry, or, you know what I mean, nothing like that. It was like, all right, this dude's trailing behind, let's go get him. We ain't gonna leave our brother behind. We ain't gonna let him stumble at the finish line. We gonna help him get across the finish line. And that's what we took to the field. You know, if the one guy made a bad play, we didn't say, oh, you sorry, bro. You need to get off the field. You know what I mean? It was like, all right, don't worry about it. We're going to get him the next time. It was like, all right, come on, man. Let's go, man. We can get this. You know what I mean? Even when we got down in games, we didn't get down on each other. We was like, all right, let's go. Let's go. Let's get back, refocus. Let's go out here. And then next drive, we're going to score. Next time, we're going to go 3-and-out. You feel me? We're going to get him off the field. From a point to where it was like, man, we can't do this. Because we felt like we can do anything because we was a team.
Yeah, that's important, man. That's definitely important, man. Because a team that's not in sync, like from top to bottom, don't have no chance of winning no championships, man. You know what I'm
saying? Yeah, man.
Yeah. Hey, man, so going into that season, man, you guys, I know you put it on us. That game was such a blur, man. It was such a blur. I looked up at the scoreboard, and it was like 41-0 or something like that, man. But we ain't going to talk about that because, you know, we ain't going to talk about Naples High. Anyways, man, talk about that season, man. Talk about that season and some memorable games and memorable players that you played against.
Man, that season, it, like I said, it started off like we was untouchable. Because, like I said, we played together and everybody was playing for each other. It was no individual talent on our team. Everybody sacrificed something on that team. We had guys transfer. Adam Gilstead transferred from Jacksonville. He came to Estero to play quarterback. You know what I mean? He ended up being one of our starting linebackers.
Yeah.
You got Mike Abar, man, probably one of the best guys, best personality. Holly never said nothing, man. He was our middle linebacker, man. Straight killer. You understand? You come through that hole, you're going to be laid out. Every game, he had somebody laid out. You know, you had D. Hall, man, backed up, man, cleaning up everything. Anything go 15 yards in the air, that's him. So, yeah. I mean, don't throw back there with D-Hall. You had Andrew Lay was just a straight dog. You know what I mean? From the receiver standpoint, and he played DB. So, as we went into the season, we actually started off in a camp in North Carolina. We, like I said, we went to Black Mountain for FCA thing. And we met some guys from Lakeland, from the Dreadnoughts. They happened to be there. So, as we going through the camp, it was like a week-long camp. We started bonding with those guys. So we was like, okay, we're going to see y'all in the regional because y'all in 5A and we in 5A. Y'all like the big dog. They was the big dog because they were in the nation. I think like 23rd in the nation, somewhere like that. So as we was bonding, it was a group of guys from Texas. They was talking like cold hard trash about Florida football, like real play this game, like they just die hard football, they eat, breathe it. It was like we were just people that just played the game, didn't understand the game. So one night we was like, all right, let's go set up this game. So the next morning we get up though, we combine with Lakeland, the Dreadnoughts, man, I swear, we beat them guys like they never played football before in their life. And so from that point on, yeah, you know what I mean? Taylor ain't got nothing on Florida. What's wrong with them? You know what I mean? So from that point on, we knew that how good Lakeland was because they had some real good talent over there. We knew how good they was, but we knew how good we was as a collective group. So we came back, reapplied everything that we had learned from that camp because it was like a skills camp too. We apply everything to our workouts with our motivation. And we knew where we wanted to get to. So, coming into the season, you know, like I said, we played against guys like Bear, the Barry Whites and all that. We knew that as long as we go out and give our max effort every play, that it was going to be tough to beat us. We had no idea that we was going to be putting up 40, 50 points a game. We had no idea, but we still had our stumble against Fort Myers. Fort Myers was always, you know, I mean, that game that everybody wanted to see, and it always came down to one play.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. So that was that season as a whole because everybody else we came out, you know, it was pretty much over by halftime. Right? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They gave us some good games, but it was like, let's go ahead, let's handle this. You know, coming out of halftime, it's like, all right, let's wake up. It's time to put these people away so we can rest up. You know what I mean? Because we worked out 6 a.m. before school started, we was working out. And then, you know what I mean? Then we still had our weight class. So that season was meant to happen because of the grind that we put in into that season.
Yeah. Well, you guys definitely pull it on. Like, Would you guys lose to Fort Myers by?
Like it'll probably be like 1 point to 5 points or 6 points. It was like I say, it was one play. Like the last time, with the first time of Junior, we lost to him. It was like a last second Hail Mary they threw, and Corey German caught it in the corner of the end zone. Yeah. You know what I mean? And then he beat us like that. You know what I mean? So it was like, it was one of them games that it was a must-see. Yeah. I mean, the whole city came out. Everybody, like, it wasn't like just a Fort Myers Estero game. It was like, let's bring the whole city together tonight. And you can see it as you walk into the stadium. It's people outside the gate still waiting to get in a packed house. Like at Estero, it was pretty much standing room only.
Right.
And there was people outside the gate sitting on top of their cars, you know what I mean, trying to get a glimpse of the game. Then we go down to Fort Myers. Fort Myers Stadium is packed.
That game must have been crazy because, like you said, Hampton was under Sirianni. And Sirianni was the innovator of that offense. And you guys basically ran the same offense. And, man, I can't imagine the formations Fort Myers came out. They came out in some crazy formation, like two linemen and like three receivers. I mean, three people here. And then a dude get under center, throw it over there. Oh, man.
We call it a swag gate. That's what on the scouting report, we call it a swag gate. You know what I mean? That's what they do. That was part of the offense. I mean, listen, you look at Phil, man, they make it look real easy, man, because they had probably one of the best quarterbacks that I ain't even mentioned, Andre McGill.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Man, he's the best quarterback. Yeah, he probably. Yeah, man, listen, this dude was absolutely the truth. And then they had Holloway in the backfield, man. This guy, man, probably was all probably about 160, 170. You know what I mean? I might be kind of exaggerating because he looked a little small on film, but his heart was so huge.
Yeah.
And then they had the Browns that played linebacker. I mean,
Savarius Brown.
Yeah, that's my cousin. And that's my cousin.
Yeah, they actually put him on me because I was pairing up their guards. But they had, like, the Coleman twins. Yeah, they were loaded, man. They were loaded.
Man, listen, Fort Myers will always be and always going to be the standard of talent in Lee County. If you can get to Fort Myers, if you can get and beat Fort Myers, you're doing something as a team. You know what I mean? Because Fort Myers always, I don't care where it comes from, Fort Myers always going to have talent. They're going to put a good football team that's going to be well coached on the field every time. So you really got to know your keys, and you really have to play your best when you play against Fort Myers.
Yeah, definitely, man. Hey, you remember playing against Lehigh? Lehigh, you
saw. Oh, man.
Some
man,
big
listen,
dudes, man.
Man,
they had like, man, some big dudes.
They didn't have big dudes. They had a big dude that was fast. Yeah. That's who Philip Buchanan played for.
Yeah.
He played for Lehigh.
Yeah.
I mean, this dude,
he was the focal point of the offense. They just ran toss sweep to both sides every play.
Well, not against the steroids. You cut that out. You know what I mean? We had guys before we played Lehigh, man, a guy named Jason Rowland. And we was in pregame warm-ups, right? This guy, I swear to you, he lined about 20 yards from the end zone, right? Run to the goal post, head on, boom, knock himself out for the game.
What?
This how it's saying, yes, man, this how it's saying. And I'm telling you, this guy was nothing but 170 pounds soaking wet with bricks, you know what I mean?
Concussion protocol.
He knocked himself out, man. Get up. It was a straight animal. I'm talking about this guy, man. Probably averaged about 20 tackles a game, man. I mean, this dude was an absolute animal, man. So, yeah. I mean, like I said, we played against Lehigh. Lehigh was by far the most talented team I think I ever played against.
Yeah.
Because they had talent on top of talent. You know what I mean? They had guys sitting on their bench that could go to any other high school and start and play. You know, so you really had to stay disciplined against Lehigh, because if you slip up, man, they gone.
Oh yeah.
It was a flash. So playing against Lehigh was always a challenge, you know. But unfortunately, we came out on top every time. So, yeah. You know, I mean, I ain't gonna even.
Boy, I remember the one dude, man. He looked like he could play in the NFL, man. The receiver they had, Melvin Scurry.
Dude, yeah, Melvin Scurry. Like
6'4", 6'5" speed, man. Big dude, man. I remember that.
But I think they had their quarterback. I want to say their quarterback at the time was, I want to say it was Maurice Fenoy or something like that. One of Fenoy's, man.
Yeah, he was a big quarterback.
Listen, man, this dude, man, you watch the dude on film. This dude was like playing Tecmo Bowl or something, man. Mm-hmm. Something, you know what I mean? This dude, he make things just look too easy. You know, and then like you said, again, they picked it to Phillip, and then they had Big Fred Wright. This guy 6'6", you know what I mean? So these guys, I tell you, man, was unreal, man. It was like you playing on a video game, because they come out, man, and you know, back then we wore the shoulder pad with the neck rolls, and you know what I mean? So they look extra big. You know? Right. So we sitting on the sideline like, man, these guys would have beat us by like 60. Cause, and then they coming out of warm-up, they running around and they flying. I was like, holy crap. So, you know what I mean? What we got? Because we was little. You could see we was little. But we had a big offensive line. But yeah, man, once the game started, though, it's on. It was a different mentality. Like I said, we was all from the hood, and we had a different street mentality that we brought to the game.
Yeah. Did you guys play Barron that year? Barron Collier?
Yeah, Joseph, was it Joseph?
Yeah, Joseph was there in Lionel Doraville.
Yeah, yeah. We played them, I want to say we beat them like 43-12 or something like that. Something like that.
Yeah,
we beat them, man. Cause they was coming. That's when they was coming out, and the quarterback they had, he was, you know what I mean? He was supposed to be that dude. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And they forgot we had some guys over there too at Estero that took that mail pretty good too.
Yeah, man. All I remember that the dive, that option dive. Next thing you know, boom, you would hit it up the gut. Next thing you know, then, you know, you key on that. Next thing you know, David Hall will pull it out and just, you know,
yep, going along. Yo, man.
And then you key in on that, and then his brother come around the corner.
Oh, plus. And then you had, but see, the biggest play that people didn't realize, like, you know, with the wing T offense, yeah, you very rarely pass the ball. Mm-hmm. But when we did throw the ball, I swear D. Hall probably threw 25 yards in the house. Now, my boy. But he get it in the hands of Andrew Layton. Mm-hmm. Andrew Layton on scope. I mean, every time you throw the ball, this man had, first of all, he was probably one of the best route runners that you could ever see in a high school game. And second of all, his hands was huge. So you get this dude the ball, man. This dude always made a play for us. And then we had this guy, God bless the dead, Josh Arizmendi.
Arizmendi. Joe Arizmendi.
Yeah.
I had a chance to meet that guy.
Yeah.
Because we were in Project Hope program. We went on a trip or something. He was a real cool dude. Yeah. Yeah, he used to come.
Yeah, we call him Mr. Third and 30. Right. say, we always, you giving the ball first, second down, he never gets a yard. He would never get a yard. But every time we was in like a third and 30 or third and 15, third and 20, we run this counter play, he get a first down every time. Every time. You go back and watch, man, every time we ran that counter play to him, he going to get you a first down, no matter what it is. It could be third and 10, third and 15, 20, 30. He going to get the first down. I don't know how he did it. That's why we always called him Mr. Third and 30. I mean, he going to get a first down.
Yeah, man. So Who was the toughest team that you felt like that year that you played against? Besides Fort Myers.
Lakeland.
Lakeland?
Lakeland was that gas. I mean, like, because it wasn't even the playing part. It was the part, the intimidation factor. First of all, when we get off the bus, if you ever been to the stadium, they you gotta walk in, and they already, they bleachers, because I guess it's like a baseball field or something like that. That's where the Detroit Tigers or somebody play there or something. Mm-hmm. All right, so when you come into the stadium, the bleachers overlook you already. So you walking up under the bleachers, and mind you, they sold out, because like I say, every game you see they blowing somebody out by like 60-70 points. You feel me? So when we get off the bus, as we walking, coming on the field, some of their fans just coughed up spit, and spit at the homeboy's face. I'm talking about a glob of spit just right there on his face. That's before we even touched the field. So now we out on in pregame. We warming up, going through our stuff that we do before the game starts. And all of a sudden, the crowd get quiet. It just get quiet. We were going about our business. And next thing you know, you hear, boom! They shoot from this cannon. They got this cannon that they shoot off. That's the first time we ever seen a cannon at a football game. So the cannon go, bah! And all of us, you know, we, from where we from, you hear that noise, somebody shooting. So we...
You got to start running. You
know, so we looking like, all right, let's find a little spot to get up under ourselves. You know what I mean? So you know, from that point on, it was like, oh, man, we done got ourselves in two. And so they just burst out on the field. I told them we only had like 22 to 25 guys. Man, they skilled guys come on the field. There's already like 70 of these skilled guys on the field. So we like, what the world is going on? So I think that kind of, it didn't shake us, but that set the tone. So they came down and they put up 14 quick points on us. Like, you know what I mean? It's quick points. But the turning point was Josh Harris Mendes. They tight end. They was going in to go up 21-0. They tight end. They had a tight end like 6'7". He was like the best. I say he was number one ranked tight end in the nation at the time. They brought him up the scene, and they forgot about this guy back here that was 150 pounds named Josh Harris Mendes. Once again, he came across, laid him out. They had to pull him off the field on a stretcher. From that point on, it is when we knew we had arrived. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And everything, it was like, at first it was like a blur because we had never seen this much talent on the field at one time. I mean, Fort Myers had talent, but it was nothing compared to what Lakeland had. Every one of their guys on their front line was over 300 pounds and could move. Their linebackers had to have been like 6'1", 6'2". And I'm talking about cock diesel type dudes. Their DBs were standing on the sideline, had to be at least, they probably have a guy under 5'11". So, I mean, if you imagine this stuff coming at you, and then all of a sudden, probably think about the third quarter, we came out of halftime, back-to-back plays, I knocked out two of their DBs, just bow, bow. So, you know what I mean? Once that happened, the whole momentum is when we grasped that, okay, this is our game right here. You know what I mean? So, yeah, they was probably the toughest team we played because of what they presented.
Yeah. So guys ended up winning that game to go to state, right?
Yeah, we won that game. We won that game 14-7. West Virginia, old man.
Yeah.
Best kick in Lee County. I mean, he came out under pressure, man. First of all, it was the catch that set it up. Adrian Holloway, probably about 5'6". You know what I mean? He went up over some giants and came down with an unbelievable pass that D-Hall logged up in the air. Adrian Hall went up, got it, he put us in field goal position. And West Virginia came out, man. We were stomping because you don't really have that much time left. So we ran all over the field, scrambling, getting guys on and off the field. He comes in that moment and kicked the field goal. We watched the field goal as it, you know, kick as it's going through. And before he, once it left his foot, we just started like, oh, it's going in. So we knew because this guy, he was like, he held it down for us the whole season.
Yeah. Wow. So you guys like overcame a 14, you know, being down behind 14 points and won.
Yeah, one. To I'm talking about this team ranked number. It was number one in Florida. It was ranked 23rd or 22nd in the nation.
Damn.
You know what I mean? And like I said, I was comfortable because that's where my family from. I had already
from
been
Lakeland?
From Lakeland. Yeah, my family, all my family is from Lakeland. So
didn't
I was already comfortable.
Some of them at a camp too.
Yeah. That's we played together. We through some of the skill competition, we had our individual battles.
Oh, okay, that's crazy.
Yeah,
man.
but we played together. We played together on as far as playing Sandlot against Texas. We played together, but yeah, our skill set was, you know what I mean, when they taught guys, our skill set was right there. Yeah. You know what I mean? It wasn't like, you know, they were that far apart.
That's crazy. So going into state, man, the state championship game, where was that at?
It was at the University of Florida.
Wow, boy. Man, take us through that week, man. How crazy was that week?
First of all, it was like we were celebrities. I mean, you couldn't go nowhere without somebody saying something to you. I mean, even the practices, we had people out there. You know what I mean? And we had huge rallies every time. So leading up to it was like living out a real life celebrity. Because like every day, I mean, Chili's would make something or do something for you. We had awesome cheerleaders. I mean, they would do something for you. The spirit of the school was like on a high demand. I mean, from not only for the school, but the community. Everybody like just really rallied. When we got ready to leave to go to state, I mean, if you could have seen it, from the time we got on the bus, it was people filled in the parking lot, like wishing us good luck as we leaving out. On the buses, we had police escort. So I mean, it was something unreal.
Man, so who you guys play?
We played Kissimmee Osceola.
Yeah,
they had at the time they had the running back, Mr. Willie Green. He was Mr.
William
Florida.
Green that went to Boston College.
Willie Green. He ended up going to Florida.
Oh, yeah, okay, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. That guy there, man, Mr. Florida, man. He was all virgin. He was all coaches virgin to Ernest Graham.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. That's if you ask for the toughest running back we played against, it had to be that guy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah, man. The dude was like absolutely green. He wasn't exposed to Ernest Graham.
Oh.
A freakish animal too.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I mean they were tough. They was like late when they had like over 100 people in their roster. They got all these people and we listen like, why the hell we can't get all these people? Yeah. But they wasn't as tough as Lakeland.
Wow.
That's the sad part. No, they wasn't as tough. They had like probably, you know, like probably one of the guys that really stood out for them. That was pretty, you know, they had a lot of talent.
So what was the score?
I want to say it was.
What was the score again?
I think it was like 28-14 or something like.
Oh, okay.
28-14. They had a reverse call. Homeboy Andrew that broke out. nobody around. And just for some reason or another, the ball just kind of popped. It just came up. I mean, we was going down. That's what the game for us. You know what I mean? He was going down, and it just popped out of hand. It was something that just happened. You know what I mean? It something you probably, it never happened again. But it just popped up out of hand. It kind of was. I mean, he had them broke out. Nobody was around. He was going in to score. And I probably would have killed the game for it, you know. But at the same time, you know, it's still the team. You know, came back, picked him up, came back, and finished the game off. But like, they go down, their body just, you know what I mean? Because they was big. So they just drove down and scored a touchdown. And they picked it off or something like that.
Okay. Yeah, man. Yeah. So, you guys take really hard though. How bad of a taste did it leave in your mouth knowing that far and you gotta go home?
We were excited because we played the whole season for each other. And we really didn't take the losses hard because the look in our brother's eye that was hurt. That's what kind of carried us because we was there to support each other.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. Because we took it pretty hard, but you know we was like, man, don't worry about it, man. It's just a game. You know, that's how it's over. You know what I mean? We was as family that it really didn't. The loss really didn't dawn on us because all we cared about at the time was our brother. You know what I mean? Our brother. You know, you could tell he was obviously going through some emotion, you know what I mean? So we was there to help him. You know, we was great. We didn't care about the game because it was a privilege in itself for us to make it to that point. Because every game leading up to that game, we was only winning by 1 point. You know what I mean? We beat four shots by one. We played another team on the other side. We beat them by one. The only team we blew out that year was Charlotte when they had Elgin Hicks. They had Elgin Hicks, and they had a running back called the Diesel. We blew them out by 14.
And man, Elgin Hicks was a monster, bro.
God.
He ended up going to Florida, I think. Didn't
he? Yeah, he went to Florida. That's where he went. But, I mean, like I say, that's why against us, he was like non-existent pretty much because Andrew Layton and I want to say Josh Plug, you know, Adrian Hall, them guys, they played, they did an awesome job on him. Coach Swat, man, hats off to him, came up with an unbelievable game plan against Elgin Hicks. I mean, probably one of the best strategic players I ever seen. And not to mention, we had guys on our coaching staff like Anthony Dixon, that the head coach South. Man, Sam Brown, one of the guys that he coached at either BC and offensive coordinator now at Dunbar. We had Coach Swatch. I think he's down in Barry Collier now as an AD, I want to say. He coached here. He's the AD at Island Coast. So we had brilliant guys on our coaching staff that gave us all the information for every team. Yeah. Every team we had a different game plan for.
Yeah, hey man, the senior year, were you excited? Because I know you guys lost a lot of people, you know, from that graduating class. What was the outlook going into that season?
Man, we thought we can get back. We knew we had the team come in because we had. We lost those guys, but we had guys that was playing with us from that sophomore class. We had guys like I say, Joe Buck. He was just a junior coming in that year. So he came back with us for the junior year. We had David Mahoney. We had Sean Penn. We had
David Mahoney. Andrew Holloway. That guy was played for the Navy, right? He was
a linebacker.
Yeah,
for Navy, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he played with us, and then we had guys return with us like Kevin Price, Mike Bishop, A-Bar, all the guys from my fresh masks all came back. You know what I mean? Even we had Harvey, we had Fight. You know what I mean? We had those guys, man. Those guys were like our receivers. You know, those guys were excellent hands and excellent route runners. So, you know, you can throw them the ball and them guys are going to be dependable. Big Bertman, man. Bertman was our tight end. We throw Bertman the ball anywhere on the field. Once he going to catch the ball. And when he catches the ball, please don't try to tackle him because it just, I mean, because the guy was big, fast, you know, and he had a little agility on him. So we knew coming back into that season we was going to be strong. And like I said, we had the work ethic to go with the talent. I mean, the coaches didn't slack on us at all. I mean, we had this thing called the mile on mile. If you didn't make your mile on mile time, you had Breakfast Club, which is during the time
we had something days. Very similar to that called the Mile High Club. Like every practice you missed, you had to run a mile for it.
Yep. So, and then what we did, we had this thing called Breakfast Club. You had to get up, right, at 6 o'clock. You had to go out there, get your workout in while we slept. And then when we came back out at, I think it was 7:30, you had to come back out and work with the team, too. So, I mean, they had. And like I said, it was no need to push ourselves harder than anybody else could push us. Everybody took pride in working out. We go in the weight room. You know, some days you go in the weight room, I don't know how it was down there, but you see kids, they play cars in the weight room. Some just go in the weight room, standing around, laughing and talking. You know what I mean? In our weight room, we had this thing that everybody tried to get to. It was called the 1,000-pound club. You know what I mean? It was a bench squat and a power clean.
Yeah.
So you had to try to add it to 1,000 pounds. So that was our goal. If you came in our weight room, that's it.
Yeah. Now it's starting to make sense, man, because that's why Coach Kramer was really good friends with Hampton. And actually, I think they mentored Hampton mentored him. You know, a lot of the stuff that you're talking about correlated with Naples High, but it was just repackaged in a different name. You know, the 1,000 pound club and things like that.
Yeah, I'm telling you, man, Hampton, that man was probably one of the most energetic little guys I ever seen. Because, you know, when you do squats, he'll come behind you. And see, I was squatting 700 pounds as a senior. Dang. He would come behind you. And when he said parallel, he literally mean parallel. It was almost like he's sitting on a toilet. You know what I mean? That's how low you pretty much had to go. And if it wasn't, if he felt like you were cheating him going halfway, he'll come behind you and he'll do the squat with you. I mean, literally be right there with you, making sure you get parallel. I mean, the guy had so much energy, man. It was insane. And if you didn't say dang garment, you better believe it's some trouble coming.
Is that gassers, you mean? And
oh, man. And that stuff? Oh, yeah. If you hear him say dang garment, you better believe. I mean, one time, man, we ran a play, man. I swear about 20 times in a row in practice because we couldn't get it right. We didn't do nothing but run that play over and over and over and over to everybody. Knew what they was doing.
So he was a detail oriented person, huh? Everything would have to be on schedule and everything, huh?
Oh my God, this guy here, man. Listen, if it ain't right, it's gonna be right. Yeah. I don't care what you doing. I don't care what you got designed. You know how most people they come in and they try to cram like 10 to 15 things on you at one time. Nah. You ain't gonna, if it takes you all day to do that one play, it's going to take all day to do that one play before he move on to something else. Yeah. Everybody knew their communication. You know, like, for instance, we had a thing called in and outing. You know what I mean? The lineman would tell you, okay, if this guy playing this guy right here, we're going to block him this way. So they'll holler, any. You know what I mean? So that lets you know the run got to be inside. But vice versa, they'll say, outie. So you know you got to go on the outside of it. You know what I mean? Everybody communicated on every level without saying something. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They knew what it had to be.
Yeah, that's real. That's what's up. Hey, that season, man. Take us through that season, man. How it transpired.
The senior year. First of all, hats out to Joe Buck, man. Joe Buck was Joe Buck, Kevin Price, man. Even Holloway Hall from my junior year, man. Those guys was the real heroes because they went inside and put a lot of blocks on them linebackers. First of all, they did all the inside dirty work, you know, especially for myself. But then when them guys got the ball, it was like they might get the ball 5-6 times a game, but they might have over 100 yards rushing and like 3 touchdowns. Because every time they got it on the sweep, it was nobody there. And they was already fast and athletic. So they just knew it. They made one guy miss, it was a touchdown. So going into that senior year, you know, me, myself, Joe Buck, guys that Kevin Price and the McKees, Bishop, we took it upon ourselves because we was now the new leaders of the program. Because now we playing with a bunch of young guys. I think we brought on probably one of the first freshmen I seen play varsity was the receiver, Michael Rucker.
Yeah.
That's what he was probably one of the first freshmen to play receiver since I was at Estero. You know, and then we had Adrian Holloway. We had a lot of young guys, the Mahomes in that class. So we knew we had to be strong leaders coming back from what we lost, because we lost Andrew Lane, who was probably the best leader we had on the team from my junior year. We had Jason Rowland, David Hall, you know, Plug. We had those guys that paved the way for us. So it was our job to pave the way for the younger class coming up now. So we pretty much set the tone in the summer. Everybody was held accountable. And if you had a time to make, we made sure you made that time. So going into the season, we started off. I can't remember who the first game was, but I want to say we came out and put the hammer down. And that's when we knew we had another special season in the making. It. And, oh, man, it was just awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, man, you couldn't script it no better because, I mean, up until the Fort Myers game, we was putting it on people. I mean, I think we beat Lehigh like 63-0 in like the middle of the second quarter.
Damn.
So, and you know, I mean, we had a bunch of running clock games. You know, the whole season just seemed easy because we was prepared, you know, through the coaching staff. Not only through the coaching staff, but the players were mentally ready to take on the challenge of what we already had, and we wanted to get back to that level.
Right. Well, you were the primary back, but if I can remember, because I was out of high school, did you share the mail with a couple other backs that year?
Yeah. What people don't realize that year, I nearly rushed for. I want to say 2,000 yards, right?
Oh, you had 2,000 that year?
Yeah, that year. And then, but my homeboy Joe Buck had ran for over 1,100 yards, right? Kevin Price had still ran for over, I think, almost 600 yards, 500 to 600 yards he ran for. So, I mean, it wasn't about me. You know what I mean? Because if you keyed in on me, these other two guys, they're going to strike it quick. So you really had to pay attention to details when you played us, because we all played for each other. It was no individual going on. Like I said, Kevin Price, Joe Buck, man, them guys, Mahoney was backup behind me at the time because he was just a sophomore, I think. He was just a sophomore. And so those guys went in there and took a lot of blunts of the blocking. You know, it was tough being a wing back for us because you had to come down and get a lot of linebackers, then you had to go through the hole, pick up linebackers head on. You know what I mean? So it was about us. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Those guys really, really sold out for us. And the guys like Burton, man, like I said, he was team with me. And we could throw him the ball anywhere on the field, and he liable to take it for a touchdown. So when I say we used to beat people bad, it was a combination of everybody putting in work.
Yeah.
Like, I might have like two touchdowns, but the running back going to have two, the wing back going to have two, the other one going to have one, Berkman going to have one, and it's all in the first half.
Wow. Hey, so,
yeah, man.
Did you guys make the playoffs that year?
Yeah, man, we made the playoffs. We was district runners-up to Fort Myers once again. Fort Myers beat us on a last-second Hail Mary again. You know what I mean? This time, what? Holloway got beat. Yeah, man, Holloway got beat. I think he tipped the ball. He had the interception. I think he tipped it up. And German once again caught the tip in the corner. I'm like, how did this play out like this? You know what I mean? It just kept playing out like that. So I think we made it to the third round that year. And we lost to St. Thomas, man. We
Aquinas?
The training. Yeah, man. That's who we lost to, man. And the thing that killed us is we had a guy named Nick Kill. It's probably one of the smallest guys on the team. He was playing quarterback. The year before that, he led us to state. David Hall had got hurt. Nick Hill was the guy that came in and led us to state. He made a lot of nice reads, and he threw because he could throw. He was a nice athlete. The dude was really, really good. And so he threw some nice passes, came in, had some nice runs, which carried us to state that year. So when we came back our senior year, he was starting quarterback, right? And for some reason or another, I don't know. That was all coaching. We never really second guessed it. They decided to take him from quarterback and put him at receiver. And they brought in a guy who was a true sophomore on a team that's just coming from state. They take this guy, put him on our team, and put him as our quarterback, which he came from Lehigh. He had all the praises, but he was just a freshman when he played for Lehigh. So he come to us as a sophomore, and I guess he had all the praises that he was going to be like this great quarterback, and somehow or another, Coach Hampton decided to put this guy probably like week five or week six or somewhere up in there, decided to put this guy at quarterback. I guess the transition period had started, you know what I mean? I guess he felt like, I don't know if he wasn't getting the production from the outside or what, but you know, we blowing out people with this guy at quarterback, this same guy. So next thing you know, he the first big game of the season come, we play against Fort Myers. This guy throws seven interceptions against Fort Myers.
Oh, he folded his tent.
Yeah, man. I mean, other than that, he was playing good. He was coming in. This dude could throw. I give him his props now. The dude had a nice ball, man. He could throw. Just Fort Myers, like I say, threw seven interceptions.
Wow.
You know, so you win playoff
game throwing seven interceptions.
Exactly. So then now we go into the playoffs. Playoffs, you know, it's back to pretty much the same concept. We put, you know, we go back with Nick. We blow out once again. You know, we doing our thing. First two games, we doing our thing. And all of a sudden, I get St. Thomas. And this time, the errors that we made against Fort Myers, you know, we still have a chance to beat Fort Myers, even with the seven interceptions that he threw. But against St. Thomas, everybody in the world know, you throw interceptions against St. Thomas, they going back for touchdowns.
Right.
So, there's another case. This guy, you know, threw another seven interceptions against St. Thomas. That's what ended my senior year. You know, but the guy did go on to have one of the best years at quarterback. I think 4,000 yards, I think they said he threw for. I mean,
you're talking about Clint? Was it Clint Martin?
Clint Martin. Yeah, Clint March.
Lorenzo. Right. They didn't they change the offense to a spread offense?
To a spread. Yeah.
With SWATs,
that next
right?
year.
SWATs.
Yep. They went to the spread.
Yeah, because you guys coach retired, and I think SWATs took over and changed it.
Right.
Fun and gun.
Right. Yeah.
Fun and gun offense.
Yeah, and they was killing people with it too. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
They was killing people, but he wasn't like. To me, he wasn't in a position because, first of all, Lehigh ran a spread offense too. We were still running the wing tee up under Coach Hampton.
Yeah.
So he wasn't a good fit for my class, my senior year.
Yeah.
You know, like I said, he could throw a nice ball. He had a nice deep ball. He was very accurate. I give him all the props in the world. Great quarterback. I mean, yeah, Nick Hill at quarterback. You know what I mean? Because we was already solid in the backfield, and he was solid. He was small, so with him having the balls in his head was the best thing for us because he could hide the ball so well. His face and carry out and his rollouts,
mm-hmm.
he could throw the ball. You know what I mean? And the waggle, we hit Berkman on a shallow cross, which was a little drag across the middle of the field, off the bootleg. So, I mean. He was accurate. Man, people couldn't stop it. I just didn't know. I didn't see the need for the change.
Yeah.
But, you know, I was only there to play football, you know?
Yeah. So, man, you rushed for 2,000 yards, man. Talk about, did you get any accolades that year, man? Did you win any trophies?
Man, and look, I was, that same year, my junior year, I was runners up to everything. I was honorable mention on everything.
Awesome.
My senior year, I was... Yeah, my senior year, I was all district, all state, all region. Pretty much just about any award you could name, I got it. You know what I mean? I never got to Mr. Florida, nothing like that. But any, like I say, all state, all region, all district, all conference, man, I had award trophies out the wazoo that year.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
That's pretty impressive because, again, 5A in that time, I mean, they all had great players around because you had like Andre McGill still playing,
yep.
right?
Barry White.
Barry White. I mean, that's a speed demon. That dude was speed demon.
Yeah,
bro.
That dude was real, man. That dude was the truth, man.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to tell you who I think. Would have been probably the best running back in Lee County history if he wouldn't have got hurt. His name was Jim Jones. This dude, he played a freshman and sophomore year, I want to say it was. This dude was like, he was like Eric Dickerson, you know what I mean?
Right.
Of our generation. Because this dude was like 6'1", 6'2", strong and fast. And he, not only was he fast, he was the fastest at 100 around in the county. So I mean, you couldn't beat him in running. So once he get the ball, he'll just take off. He played for Riverdale. So I mean, if he wouldn't have got that little injury he had to his arm, by far he would have been one of the best running backs I think in Lee County history.
Yeah. Now, did Lorenzo Johnson play that year? Would you play? Because he came out of nowhere. Nah.
He was here. I graduated, so he was there that next year on the spread, and they went to the spread office.
But was a freshman when you were a senior?
No, he transferred in. I think he was at a different school. I want to say I don't know if he went to North. He went to a different school. He transferred in. I think Greg was playing with us. Yeah, he transferred in from another school, and them guys, man. That's when they had like they was freakish. They was, oh my God, it was perfect because they had the spread and they had Mickey Bradley. I think they had Greg. I mean, they had the package to run spread offense because you couldn't guard nobody on their team 1-on-1. And then I think they moved Mahoney and Lorenzo in the backfield. So. If you imagine them two guys coming at you in a spread formation, you 1-on-1 with the linebacker, I mean, it was trouble all over the field.
Yeah, yeah. So, did you know, rushing for 2,000 yards, man. You know, this is like, you know, before YouTube and all that. How hard were you getting recruited?
Well, it was, you know what's funny? We didn't get, and this is a policy that I guess they had installed at Estero. We did not get a single letter until the end of football season because they were afraid of complacency.
Wow.
So I never knew the amount of letters I had until the last game of my senior year. I had never had received a single letter until the last game. And when I got my shoe boxes, and I say shoe boxes,
yeah,
full of letters from them guys. So I never went on no recruiting trip or nothing like that.
So who was on you?
Man, I had, like, from the letters that I had in the shoe boxes, it was like I had, like, a lot of letters from South Carolina, Auburn, a lot of stuff in schools.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But like I say, I never, and one of my biggest things was nobody never really sat down. It was like, you gotta take the SAT, you know what I mean? Stuff like that. Yeah, nobody never sat down and told me that I had to take that stuff because, like I say, I never really played football. I never was really big on football until, you know what I mean, I reached the high school level as a freshman.
Right.
So I never knew anything about that kind of stuff. I thought you played football, you go to college. I did not know at the time that it was an SAT, ACT, stuff like that because nobody in my family had never graduated high school. So I was like the first in my family just to graduate high school.
Okay.
My immediate family. So you know what I mean? I never knew about that stuff. And then once I got the shoeboxes at the end, I only took the SAT like one time, man. And that was my last year of my senior year.
So did you get any offers?
Yeah, well, I ended up going to Wisconsin. A school in Wisconsin.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I did. It was a guy that came through. We signed up. I went there. You know what I mean? But, you know, hadn't I was prepared, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I probably could have went to a better school. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because, like I said, a lot of schools, man, Georgia, all of them. If I could have just kept the letters and showed you the letters that I had, man, I'm talking about I had shoeboxes full of nothing but letters.
Yeah.
That I never seen until I picked up my last year. It kind of hurted me from that standpoint. Because like I say, it was nobody there to tell me that this is stuff you have to do to get to that level.
I hear that story so much, man. And it's kind of disheartening, man. You know, because a lot of these big-time football players, man, you know, they go into their senior year of the man, and then, you know, they have a, you know, tremendous season, and then they miss out on a lot of stuff because the academic part is probably like 50 to 60% of the struggle to get in
there, right?
You know, because, you know, with two rushing for almost that many yards and having that, you know, many, you know, good seasons, man, you were probably in the driver's seat to, you know, to be like at one of those big D1 programs, man.
Exactly. And not only that, man, see, I led the county in rushing and the region. I led the region in rushing and scoring. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, and I think our region had like, what, 16 teams in it at that time? So,
yeah, well,
I mean,
it was,
you know what I mean? So it was, you know, everything was set up. It was, I didn't know enough. You know, I was just playing the game. You know, go to school, play the game. That's what I was doing. I was just loving the fact that I was playing football and we was a team.
Yeah.
I never had that. I never had that bonding experience like that because I never had the privilege to play Pop Warner.
Yeah. Yeah, so when you you didn't. I'm just kind of like scratching my head. Like nobody didn't come. Like even like you know, recruiter. You know, take you under their wing and be like, hey, you know what? You know, you can go to junior college and you know, get out of junior college and then you can go out here. Nobody didn't take you under their wing to get you prepared for this.
Listen, I didn't receive a single letter to the end of my senior year.
Wow. That's
a single letter. Yeah. All that stuff was coming to the school, but I never received one.
That's crazy.
You know what I mean? Nobody never sat down to the end of my senior year. Don't get me wrong. Now, a guy, Ed, Coach Ed, he came to Estero. That was pretty much who recruited me. He stayed with me through the whole process. You know what I mean? Once I was able to establish something, he came, talked to me, and I was able to get my whole butt, which is, well, sitting there, I see a Chill, which was another great quarterback on our team, great athlete, you know what I mean? Was able to help. We got this school together. You know what I mean? And he had already graduated the year before. So it told you something right there about the way things were set up at Estero.
Oh, okay.
You know, even though we had the success, but, you know, nobody really, unless you already knew something previous or something, you know what I mean, or you had some help already, nobody really was like, this is what you're supposed to be doing, this is the classes you need to be taking, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but you guys had Anthony Dixon on your staff, none of them ain't reach out?
Man, listen, no knock against them guys. Coach Hampton was a guy, he didn't want nobody to think they was bigger than the team.
Okay.
That was the concept, and that was the philosophy. He wanted to keep a team. I don't hold it against the guy. I really don't. You know what I mean? I understand now, but I didn't then. But, yeah, he didn't want nobody thinking that they was bigger than the team. It was always about the team. You know, there was a lot of guys on that team, man, that could have went to a lot better places than where they went. I mean, we had some guys go to UConn, some guys go to Florida. You know what I mean?
Yes.
But those were the guys that stayed down there. You feel that they was already, their parents, their life was already established.
Okay.
So.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And like I said, no knock against none of them guys, you know, because they could only do what they could do. That was their first year, so they was pretty much on like a volunteer basis. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That was their first year coaching.
Yeah. Hey, so talk about that experience, man, at that college. What was the name of it?
We went to UW Stout. I mean, it was the college life is a different. It's a different life than anything you can ever experience anywhere. And in Wisconsin, anybody know anything about Wisconsin? It's like that they preach football. They eat, the whole state breed football. You know what I mean? So going up there, you don't have nobody to wake you up and say, it's time to go to class. You know what I mean? Yeah. Nobody there to hold your hand and say, this stuff you're supposed to be doing. You got to get up and you have to do it. First, you have to make sure you got your good counselor, somebody who can set you in the right classes to, you know what I mean, so you could be prepared. And then now you have the party life. You know what I mean? Like I say, we were some dudes for 4 miles. You know, we went to a club. You never experienced what a basement party was like.
Yeah.
So you only see stuff like that in the movies. So when you got a chance to go to a basement party, I mean, when I tell you it was hot and crazy, insane, I mean, it's some stuff that going at them basement parties, boy, that it's better than a club.
Yeah. Nah, I've been there. I was in Pennsylvania. They had plenty of basements.
So you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
It goes down.
It goes down, dog. It's culture shock, too, man. Especially
because
it's cold and it's just way different, man.
And that's the thing. When we went up there, man, we kind of we kind of changed the environment. We kind of changed the way things went. Because, like, when I went up there, I was blessed to go up there with my best friend, which is my brother, Rochelle Garcia Chill. I was blessed to, because, and we had another guy from Ocala. He ended up playing for Detroit Lions. His name was Tony Beckham. He kind of, him and a guy named Rick, and another guy from Ocala, they kind of took us around and they groomed us, you know what I mean? They showed us, you know, what to do and what not to do. You know, if we need anything, come talk to them. And those are the guys we stayed with as freshmen, you know, coming in. And so those guys was like huge to everything that we was doing at the time. And when we got there, it was like, okay, freshmen, y'all supposed to do this. Or y'all supposed to do this. They even tried to make us go outside and shovel snow. But like I told you before, we were from 4 to 24. You know what I mean? We don't just, you ain't going to just boss us around.
Yeah.
So you take us a pain in the hood, guys. Up and you put us now with a bunch of country folks. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Nah, it don't work like that. So we kind of changed the guy. You know what I mean? We didn't really so far change it, but we kind of, you know, you don't walk around like this. This is how you're supposed to walk around. This is how we walk around in Florida. This is what Florida guys do.
Yeah, this is you how know? We move over here.
Yeah, y'all, it ain't none of that stuff y'all used to when y'all think y'all initiate people. No, we having that now. Yeah, I mean, real cat, because they try to get us to come in. They want to clean the house, wash their dishes, and, oh, no, wash their coat. Oh, no. The game ain't played like this where we from. You know what I mean? Where we from, we fight about stuff like this. This thing is real.
Yeah.
So we came to understand it real quick that, hey, you know what I mean? You ain't going to just handle us like this. But it was all cool because it was out of love. You know, they showed us so much and did so much for us.
But they did get you guys on the football field for initiation or something, right?
Yeah, I told you, they tried.
But I thought that was off the field, but they got you probably after practice.
We weren't having that, man. We weren't having that. Oh. I'm telling you, man, we were not having that. Yeah, like, I mean, they got us one time to go out there and shovel snow. That was the closest they came to us. Okay. Other than that, we was not having that, man. That's just, y'all know, like, I guess guys from Florida, we have a different mentality. Yeah. All that nation stuff, that stuff is out. Hey, that ain't happening. We ain't gonna let you just handle it any kind of way, man.
Yeah.
We might have to sneak and catch up while we sleep.
Yeah, talk about
playing.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, that was good.
No, I was just saying, talk about playing. What was it?
It was Division 3.
Division 3? Yeah.
Yeah, Division 3. And that was like one of the top 10 leagues in the, you know what I mean, the country at the time.
Okay. Well, Mountain Union, you know what I mean? Wisconsin, Whitewater?
Yes. That's the team we played against.
Okay.
We had Mountain Union. We had Mountain Union beat a freshman, Bungard. He was starting back. He was senior. He fumbled on the goal line going in, and that's how they beat us. They just got the ball kneeled at the second. We had them at the last second. You know what I mean? That was tough. It was tough up there. Football up there is a little different here because, you know, like, even it don't snow here, it rains. But up there, like, when it snowed, we still couldn't put gloves on. Like you never could wear gloves or you couldn't wear long sleeves.
Why?
So, because it was just the policy that the coach had in place. The linemen couldn't wear it. That's the only thing the linemen had probably was a helmet, and they had knee braces. But other than that, the linemen couldn't wear nothing. So it was one of those type coaches that he was straight old school, good kid, good guy, man. Probably one of the best guys I met as far as the coaches standpoint, because he was what you call a player's coach, and then he was already in tight with Tennessee coach Fisher at the time. So we met a lot of guys through him.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he was a real good dude.
So how many years did you play there?
I finished one season, man. That was it.
Did you get any playing time?
Nah, I didn't really get probably nothing. Because, like, what happened was I came back, and my wife, she got pregnant at the time. Mm-hmm. So, but I was projected to be the starting back that next year.
Oh, okay.
Put me in the office and everything. They told me I was projected to be a starting back. Listen, man, I was in practice. I was a monster.
Well, they probably had, like, that senior bias and, you know, you and your dudes type thing.
Yeah, and that's what it was, because the guys that was in front of me was all seniors. I mean, they was like, no, you know what I mean, no slouches. Them guys was already in the program.
Yeah.
So, like I say, it was a learning curve for me.
Yeah.
You know, I wish I was more prepared, to say the least. I wasn't prepared enough. So that's why one of the things I tell the kids now is prepare yourself early. So you can understand what's going to happen later.
Yeah, man. Going through all that football, man, what were some of your biggest regrets, man? And the most memorable things?
My biggest regrets was not prepared for the life after.
Yeah?
Yeah, that's one of my biggest regrets, because anything through football was an accomplishment itself. Because, like I say, in my family, I was the first to do a lot of stuff. You know? So it was... I never really hold any regrets. I just was not prepared enough for life after.
Yeah. So what are some revelations, dog, that you had, you know, after that whole, you know, experience of playing football?
From a standpoint, it's just understanding people, understanding different cultures, understanding different environments. Because I came from a rough and ragged environment. Then I went to an environment that was stable with stability. And if that makes sense to you? Yeah.
No, absolutely makes a lot of sense. It gives you a different perspective on everything when you see something else than what you come up from, you know. It kind of gives you hope in a little bit. You know, like, we live like this, but you know what? I got a taste of this, and it ain't got to be like this. You know what I'm saying? That's
exactly.
That's I take it from me. Yeah. Yeah, man. So what you got going? Go ahead.
And then another thing you learn, too. You learn communication. And I think that's the problem with some of our young folks now. They don't know how to communicate with the elderly. It's no sense of respect, the responsibility, you know what I mean, responsibility towards people anymore. So it's a huge, I learned so much through those years that it prepares me now.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I totally agree with that, man. With the respect part, man, it's like, to this day, like, I don't care if somebody that's an OG, somebody that's older than me, you know, it ain't gotta be. I'm gonna give them a certain level of respect regardless. You know what I'm saying? And I think that the youth need to do that, man. A lot of times, man, like, you know, even the older cats that wasn't as accomplished as me when I was, you know, coming up, I would still give them respect just because they were older than me and I felt like they deserved the respect. You know what I'm saying? Now it seemed like these young cats, like, you really have to prove something to them. Like, you know, respect shouldn't be automatic, you know?
But see, the problem with the young folks is babies. Raising babies.
Yeah.
And see, if they ain't had no respect for elderly coming up, how can they teach their kids how to have respect? You understand?
Yeah.
And then a lot of kids, I've never been put in a situation, so I really can't say
But a lot of kids always say, if my daddy was around or if this person was around, I'll be different. But I always used to tell them, just because my father was deaf don't mean he was deaf. You feel me? If you kind of understand what I'm saying, because when I was coming up, my daddy was a huge alcoholic. My daddy was deaf. You know, and I tell people, your mother has to be the backbone of the family. She has to be the person that laid the foundation. And my mother was a strong individual.
Yeah.
You know, my mother showed me so much on how to be a man that my father, all he had to do was be there and say, son, do your best. You know what I mean? Because my mother already laid the foundation. Now with a lot of young women these days, they don't have a foundation because their obligation is to the club.
Yeah. You're right. Yeah, you're right, dog. That's crazy, man. I was thinking like something similar. It's like the obligation, you know, I understand, like, you know, people want to have a life, but when you put a life into this world, it shouldn't have to be a number one priority. It should just be the number one priority. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
You shouldn't feel like you're making a sacrifice. It's just what it is. Just like you have a nose, just how you have a mouth. I mean, this is part of you. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, and I'm not saying I don't go out because, you know, me and my wife, we step out occasionally too.
Yeah.
But at in the day, you got to see the big picture.
Yeah. Oh, like, absolutely.
You know what I mean? One of my cousins that I have raised, you know, kind of showing the game, how to play the game. He was killed like last year, man. You know, he was shot in the head. They left him on the porch. You feel what? Me? Yeah, man. They left him on the porch, bro. You know, they didn't even take the time to take him out the chair. You know, they just left him laying in the chair. Get good kid, this wrong situation at the wrong time. But the moral is, if we take the time, if we could take 10 to 15 minutes a day to kids while they're younger, we could prevent some of the stuff that's happening right now.
You know, absolutely, man. Mentorship.
You're right. And that's the problem. Is nobody want to play a mentor because they're all about getting money. And what our kids seeing now is if we see Joe or Rob or somebody, you know what I mean? They got money. They flashing the money. They showing the big car. They showing like how they go to the strip club and able to throw money. But Rob and Joe ain't coming back telling Dad and Mark that I messed up at a young age, so this is the life I got to live. So let me show you not how to do the things that I'm doing, but let me help guide you in a different direction, do something different, so you don't have to be out here. This is what I have to do because of my mistakes that I made. Now I'm giving you the opportunity so you don't have to live through the mistakes that I'm making. I don't want to see you out in the streets, you know what I mean, trying to run out with the plug. Right. You see what I mean? I want to see you go sit up in these people's classrooms and get this free degree that they're going to give you if you can just take your butt to school and educate yourself. Instead of working in the streets, you're going to be employing people to work for you.
Right. Yeah, you know what, man? I wish, you know how, like, you know, a bunch of dudes always say, I keep it 100. I keep it all the way real. I wish people would keep it all the way real. You know, like some of those cats that be, you know, flossing and stunting and stuff like that. Why don't they tell the kids the whole story, you know, about how, like, they insecure because they can't, you know what I'm saying, take care of they peoples, about how they paranoid, you know what I'm saying, like, they can't sleep. You know, you got to get on all kinds of drugs. You know what I'm saying? That part of the game, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, how it was in prison where, you know, that part of the game, I wish a lot of these older cats that's been through it would give that to the youth. You know what I'm saying? They keep it all the way 100. You know, I'm doing this stunting, but, you know, there's a whole different side to this.
But you gotta realize, I ain't gonna tell you how to die. I'm gonna tell you how to live.
Right.
You feel me? I ain't gonna tell you that what I had to go through to get this band in my pocket. I'm gonna show you how I got this band in my pocket. You know, why would I waste time giving you the negative feedback when it's so much of the positive stuff that I can fool you with? You know, it's just like a cigarette ad commercial. Everybody smoke because they think it's cool. But they ain't going to tell you about the cancer that's coming with the cigarette that you just put in your mouth. But we just going to show you that it's cool to smoke. You know, it's a lot of stuff that I wish that people of today would just take the time to go over with their children. I mean, they don't have to sit down and tell them, you know, because sometimes some kid, you have to find out on your own that how to do certain things. Yeah, a parent can only tell you some experiences that they went through. It's still some stuff in life that we as people have to figure out. You know, like, for instance, why when we go to college, everybody always say you need a degree to make it in this world, right? Why would nobody sit down and tell you it ain't so much about a degree, it's about the people that you meet along the way while getting that degree.
No, you're absolutely right on that, and I tell a lot of people, man, you know what? College is basically a social experiment, because all the people that's in, like, first of all, a lot of the stuff that you learn in college, I mean, you're going to use some of it, but unless you're going to be a doctor, lawyer, and all that stuff, you're really not going to use like 90% of what you learn. Most of the time, right, it's going to be the people that you meet, you know,
right,
either through your fraternity, either through your class, or that's going to be the one that sets you up for success, you know?
Exactly. And that's one of the things that I found out in life that nobody never told me. It's not about what you did. It's who you know.
Yeah.
It's who you know, man. It's that impression that you make on that person when you meet that person. That's the stuff that deals with relationships with people. It's not about how much money in your pocket or the things that you could do. It's about that impression that you make on the next person. Because to me, word of mouth is the biggest thing that really in today's society.
Yeah.
Because if somebody got positive feedback on you, believe me, somebody out there paying attention.
Yeah. Yeah, I read a book called The 48 Laws of Power, and in the book it says, man, your reputation is everything. Guard it with your life, because that one time that you act out a character, you know, could be the wrong time, and that can set you in a different path, man.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. And that is so true. Are you, what's that book called? 48 Powers?
No, 48 Laws of Power.
48 Laws. I'm going to look that up, man. That's one thing I'm trying to do with my kids now, is I am trying to get them to understand the concept of reading.
Yeah.
That's the problem I think we as people now, we fail. Because we don't read enough to educate ourselves with the mathematics and the numbers and all that.
Oh, absolutely, but, man! It's if you're crazy. Not, yeah, that's why they said, man. You ever heard that old saying, like, if you want to keep something from a Negro, in a book,
put a book in his hand. Yo.
Or no, you, keep, yeah. You put it in the book. You put it in the book.
Put it in the book. Put it.
Yeah, the Negro will never read it. There's so much stuff that I've just learned, man. I mean, the game is there. It's there. It's just you got to take the time to read and, like, educate yourself, man. Enrich yourself, bro.
It's there. Yeah, and that's the thing. Like I said, I try to tell mine because, like I said, I found out through reading. Reading helps you communicate with people.
Oh, yeah.
And as long as you can communicate in this world just off your communication skill alone, you know, but you can't come to a man that already got power and be like, "Hey, bro, ain't that what happened?" You know what I mean? Yeah. That's stuff you do with your homeboys. You don't do that when you trying to go to a different place. I'm not saying you have to act out of character. I'm saying you got to prepare yourself for success, just like anything else you do in this world.
Oh, absolutely, man! It only just takes one time for somebody to judge you. You know, we all judge people, man. And, you know, and everything, every interaction, a lot of times is small samples. And if you give that person that small sample and that's all they have to judge you by, guess what they're going to use? That small sample.
That's small. Yep. That's small sample. You're right about that, man. You're definitely real about that, man. I give you props to that.
Yeah, so what you got going on, man, these days, man? Are you involved in football?
Yeah, like I said, I've been coaching at Dunbar now, like, the last 6 years, man. What a pleasant experience that has been, man.
You got quite a specimen on your hand. Are you coaching running back?
Yeah, that's what I coach. I coach running back. You know what I mean?
Abraham.
You got this guy, Abraham, I'm trying to tell you. Man, listen, it ain't so much about Abraham, man, that Abraham is just a piece of the puzzle. You feel me? You got guys like Quavi, one of the inside linemen, man, that's going to do good work. You got guys like Kenny Benjamin, man, probably the best freakish athlete on the team. You got Tyreek Thomas, man, just absolute animal. Then you got Seneca Wiley. Millich, I think his last name is. Yeah. Hewitt, man. Track guy, man, that's translation to the football field is just awesome. You know what I mean? They got it's something over there, man, that's just so powerful that I wish people would hold on and grab and take more pride into what Dunbar doing with his program. You know, if people take the opportunity to just go by them sometimes and just sit there for a second and look, it's really something positive in the making it that they got a chance. They got a chance this year, man, to do something real special. But it's going to the community. And when I say the community, because Dunbar is one of the most predominantly black schools in the area. Yeah. With a lot of talent, but no support.
I'm literally down the street, like like a hop and a skip from there.
Yeah, so I'm so sad. If people like yourself, man, you go out, man, just do something. Cause like, you know, like Fort Myers just won the championship in the girls basketball, right? And they did like this huge article on Fort Myers. No knock to Fort Myers. Lord knows, no knock. But Dunbar girls basketball program done been there like last 4 or 5 years. You know what I mean? They done made that their second home. You know, but they don't get all the exposure that they deserve. It's a great guy down there, you know, named Donnell. He got a great staff that's up under him. You know, he deserves a little bit more credit than, you know what I mean, a lot of people support, but he should, you know what I mean? The community should really be grasping a hold because it's right in the city. It's right in the area where all the crime is happening. But yet, it's still positiveness. And shout out to Burnside for what he's doing for the school. It's still positiveness right inside his own community. But they don't have the mega support as if a Naples or, a, you know what I mean, a Fort Myers or something like that. It don't have the support tree like other places.
Yeah. Yeah. So you is that what you're mainly doing is just coaching right now?
Well, yeah, I'm pretty much just coaching, man, trying to raise my kids.
Okay.
You know, I try to help lead my kids in the right direction because I got four kids myself. Yeah. So you know what I mean? It's all work, and then I'm getting them involved with this. They got this new place down here. They call it's a training facility that one of the guys, Andrew Layton and Toe, they put on. Man, it's something. It's called Better Athletes. That's what it's called. I mean, that's something. Yeah, it's something that if you want to interview somebody, man, shout out to them boys, man, because what they doing for the community right now, man, is something big. Yesterday, I just took the kids. They had their first annual combine. You know what I mean? So they really trying to do something with the kids in our city. But we got to get more people
to really want to rally around them. Is there a website
he on Facebook. He on Facebook. Look up Better Athlete. You know what? I tell you what. Look up Andrew Layton.
Anthony Layton. You guys hear that?
No, Andrew. Andrew. Andrew Layton.
Okay.
Andrew Layton. Look up Andrew Layton with Better Athlete, man.
Okay.
I'm telling you, man, what they doing right now is something that I wish I had. When I was coming up, we had a guy go by the name of Dondrick Rowe. Everybody
should know. Hold on a second. I
got to
get something.
Off air. Yeah. Andrew Layton, man. And these guys, man, they really good guys. Like I said, they grew up half of them. They grew up in the project. You know, they went out to school. They played a little ball. You know, now they coming back. They train an athlete. They train the athletes of tomorrow.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So what they doing right now, it's something that I'm proud to have my kids up there, because not only does it give your kid that second, but that minute that he's training, you know he's not hanging out with the guys he shouldn't be with.
Right.
You know, and if we can get more people involved in just trying to help steer those guys in the right direction, keep some of my kids up and put them somewhere doing something positive, then we'll be straight. But yeah, those guys doing something real good. They just started it.
Yeah, man. We definitely need something like that, man. You know, take it back, you know, to the days where, you know, it's not just, you know, all about sports. It's all about just building relationships with other people and camaraderie,
right,
and things like that. That's very, very important, man. Man, this is such my girl, Audrey. Yeah, I don't know if you remember her, man. She used to work with your wife, man.
Yeah, man. So listen, you stay in Italy, huh?
Yeah, well, I didn't stay there. She lived over there.
Oh my God! and listen, the world is so small. I think she's pregnant now. That's your kid?
Yes, that's my
baby. Oh my God! Oh my God! Yes, she just told me she was pregnant the other day.
Yeah.
I was like, wow.
Yes.
Yeah, wow, crazy. It is a small world, man. Yeah. I Audrey was, well, she was probably one of the coolest people I met too, man.
Yeah.
She was crazy.
Yeah.
I told her, she should have hung out with her a little bit more.
Yeah, because she came. I think she had some family members that stayed like two doors down from.
My uncle. My uncle stayed right next door to him. She stayed right out here in Lehigh, man. Right off Gordon, they stayed off of.
Yeah. Right over there. Yeah.
Wow, it was a small road. Yeah. Wow.
Because when I saw your page and I saw your wife, I was like, yeah, I know her. Yeah, she was friends with Audrey. Yeah, that's crazy, man.
Yeah, that's her. Yeah, man. Yeah. I've been with that girl, man, since we were juniors in high school.
Wow.
Yeah, man. We've been together for a long time. You know what I mean? Through everything. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And Lord knows she put up a lot for me. I put up something, you know, with her. You know, but
that's usually how it is, man. Give or take.
You know what I mean? Through it all, we got one common goal, man, and that's just to take care of our family You know what I mean? The best way we can.
Absolutely,
you
know? Man.
And it's blessings because, like I said, nowadays a lot of kids don't have the opportunity to have a mother, father in the same house, let alone stability with mother and father. Like I said, we had our share. I ain't gonna tell you it was sweet every day. That's a lot. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But that's what you go through once you try to build something.
Oh, absolutely, man. Those trials and tribulations, man. I mean, that's what it's all about. Making it through all those things, man.
Yeah, man. Yeah, because, I mean, it's just like the game, man. When you playing ball, man, it's easy. Everybody would be doing it. You know, you have to sacrifice yourself for the benefit of somebody else.
Yeah.
You know, do you miss that single life? Absolutely. I never experienced. Like I said, I've been with her since I was a senior in high school. Single life was never really there for me. Through my 20s, I was doing one person, you know. But it's still, it almost like you lose a part of you to gain another part of you. To show your kids, This is where you want to be. You want to be with somebody who you happy with being with. Not only like I see my wife, but she also my best friend.
That's what a wife is supposed to be, man. A lot of people get it twisted, dog. It's like, hey, your best friend. You know what I'm saying? You're everything, man.
Yeah. So I mean, like I said, it truly has been a learning experience for myself. You know, to go through some of the things and see some of the things that you see that's in the process of building a relationship, because a lot of people get a relationship, I think, these days twisted through sex. You know, a woman only as good as she is. She can be the best sex, but can she cook? Can she clean? Do she have a motivation to work? Do she have a motivation to want to be something and take a hold of this life?
Yeah.
You know, that's the keys, I think, that keep it going.
Yeah. No, it definitely. You know what? It's funny. It's almost like you have to become grown to really see it. You know, when you're a young man, you know, you think about, you know, being in, you know, I want the baddest female, this and that. And then, hey, and then you realize real soon that is not what it's cracked up to be, man. If you just
look at
that, just like from that perspective, though, you're going to be sadly disappointed, man, because, you know, having a, you know, a good woman it takes a lot more than that.
Yeah, see, because, like I said, the thing that I think, Kevin, you know, with the coaching, it takes so much out your life. And not only was I coaching, but, you know, I was throwing papers, you know what I mean, newspapers, and then I still have my regular job that I go to. So, you know what I mean, I was never home. I would come home for a couple of hours, and I was back here doing something else. You know what I mean? So, you have to have somebody there that's going to hold it down. And she might not support it all the time, but she going to be there. You feel me? And so that's why I said, like, I had to learn at a young age how to tolerate some stuff. You know, because I'm a tolerant guy, man. I know. But I had to learn how to deal with stuff like that.
Yeah. For sure. Hey, you got anything to plug, man? Any businesses, man? Any shots out, man?
Man, listen, to me, man, I don't, like, really shout out business, but I really want to shout out the whole Fort Myers as a community. You understand? Because through everything that's going on with the killing and the young kids with the guns, this community still trying to stay strong even when the so-called watchers ain't really helping support what's going on in our community. The community still stands strong, and we still got people like Junior with better athletes, and Coach Donnell at Dumbach with Coach Terrell at Fort Myers. You know, the other coaches at Dixon at South, the other guys that you really don't hear about that are still trying to make a positive impact on the kids' lives in our community. I want to shout out to everybody that still continues to live out Fort Myers, because this is one of the greatest cities in the world to be a part of, because people don't realize how much talent we have in such a small city. It's a lot of talent spread everywhere. If we could just take the time, take 15, 20 minutes out of the day to encourage everybody to be part of somebody's life, for whatever reason it might be, then we could keep our community strong. We don't need the watchers, because we can start watching over our own city.
No doubt, bro. No doubt, man. That's what's up, man. But anyways, man, thank you so much for coming on No Cupcake Zone. And for everybody out there, man, please go to Spreaker and look up No Cupcake Zone, and also go to iTunes if you have iPhone and look up No Cupcake Zone. Remember to subscribe and follow with me. You would get this podcast and all my rest of my podcasts, and in any future podcasts, you'll be alerted. Man, thank you so much again, Travis, man, for coming on there, man. Yo, man, got love for you. Hey, man. You're welcome anytime to come back on the show, bro.
All right, man. I appreciate it, Marius. Hey, man, listen, you tell Audrey, I said, what's up, man? And, man, listen, man, shout out to yourself, man. Make sure you put this on there. Shout out to you for making an impact and the impact that you're going to make in our community, man. Keep it up, man, and blessings. And I mean blessings.
I appreciate that, man. Thank you. You heard it, Lee County, man. I'm coming for you guys, bro. Number one podcast.
Another thing, too, man. This person, this off the books right here. Now, I read something. I guess you and some other guy were going through something. He had said something about you or something like that of that nature. I was reading on, I think, one of your sites, one of your pages.
Yeah.
Man, listen, man. Negative guys. Don't argue with no negative guys. Stay focused on the plan, man. It's a plan for you, bro.
Absolutely,
man. Leave them cats alone, man. Ain't no place in this world for negativeness. Let them guys have that. Let them deal with that.
Yeah.
Keep doing it, man. And I'm here, bro. I'm going to support you everywhere I can. If I catch on right now, I ain't got no iPhone now, because I got Android.
Yep.
So when I go download, no cupcakes on or something.
Yeah, man. You can go to Spreaker and download. Just go to Spreaker and look up No Cupcake Zone. Actually, you know what I'll do? I got to do some, a little bit of work on this podcast. But as soon as I drop it, I'm going to definitely tag you on it. And, you can go on there and, share it to anybody, bro.
Man, do it, man. Listen, anything I can do, man, to help, brother, let me know, man. Listen, I'm not afraid to go anywhere in the community, man, and talk to people, bro. Like, anything, you know, so that's one of the strengths, man. Let's build something, you know what I mean?
Absolutely, bro. Yeah. We need it, man. We need it, man. It can be the start of something, man. Definitely. Definitely, bro. Yeah.
And I'm going to let my wife know as soon as she get home from work, man. I'm going to tell her, make sure she hit Audrey up, man.
Yeah, they be talking about some stupid stuff, man. They be talking about, like, Real Housewives and
Yeah, you know what I mean? I used to be like, man, come on, man. You need to leave that reality alone. That ain't reality, man. That's stuff that I'll be editing cut, man.
They be killing me with that, man. I'm like, I don't want to hear this, man.
But, man, like I said, once again, man, been blessing, man. Just keep up the good work, what you're doing, man. And in the future, man, just whatever, man, I'm going to keep an eye out for you, man. Keep it strong. And good luck with the babe, man.
All right, man. Thanks, man. Be easy, bro.
Yeah, you too, man. Have a good one.
All right, you too, bro.
Yeah.